and to fix it. So now you got people walking around naked, thinking that they're looking feminine, when all they're looking is sexy. And it is not the masculine that they are attracting, but simply the male. Okay? In all his raw form, all right? Because to be masculine, it takes a little discipline. You see what I mean? Which means that, you know, a man has a little discipline about himself, and he's a truly masculine man, all right? But when he's just a male, and you coming at him with that, with them half-clothed bodies, and the whole world has just been turned into a whole body factory. I know I looked at a commercial on Blog Talk Radio on the side there, and they got some little program where it asked them, could you create the perfect woman or something like that. I know I had wrote it down somewhere, but it was unbelievable. They got this little thing where you can pick body parts and make the perfect woman. Okay, I Googled it to try to see if they had one for men. Guess what? They don't. So this gives us an idea of the society, the type of society that we live in, and how it really views women, and that is as a damn body part. Okay? That is as body parts. And you know what? I have did a little research and read what it is. You know, they did some kind of study that showed what kind of woman that men really were attracted to. And the research said that that heterosexual men may be aroused by childlike smooth skin, big eyes and small noses and chins, though there are cultural differences in those preferences. Now, this is what I want to say, is that they're socialized to be aroused by these characteristics. But guess what? These are also pedophilic in nature, as far as I'm concerned. It seems like to me they want a kid, because this is how a kid looks. Little nose, little chins, childlike smooth skin, big eyes, long lashes, high-pitched voices, okay? Sounds like the Greco-Roman culture carries on. Sounds like what he really wants is a little child, a pedophile. That's what it sounds like according to this, what they say, what they'll be aroused by. Do you know what aroused means? Aroused. That's sexual. Aroused. In this culture. So they are socialized to be aroused by these features. But in my opinion, I think it's pedophilic, actually, when I look at those descriptions. And then another thing they like, what particularly in the Western culture, is they like large breasts. Not just the breast itself, but the cleavage between the breasts. And isn't that something? So now you got women going out, buying all these patches and uplift wire bras and all this stuff so that they can push their breasts up and have 14 inches of cleavage at their command so that men would be attracted to them. I mean, this is men putting this stuff out. Women ain't creating this stuff. This is men creating this stuff for women, okay? Fooling us, telling us that this is feminine, okay? I mean, it's unbelievable. Pads and inserts, I mean, all this kind of stuff. People going to get breast implants, you know, it's unbelievable the authorizations that women undergo just so they can have, be attracted to a man, and supposedly feel feminine. You know what I'm saying? Because when they talk about women, you know, women enlarging their breasts and doing all this kind of stuff to themselves, they have not came up with sewing on no extra penis, have they? I mean, I haven't heard of it yet. But they got all kind of pills that they say that are making cross with. They ain't letting them touch it with no scalpel trying to enhance themselves, okay? No, men are not going to be doing that, all right? But anyway, Haiti Blue, what'd you say? Haiti Blue said, we've been given the socially engineered. Oh, yeah, Haiti Blue. So there was a time where you could just walk around and breasts were out and it wasn't an issue, right? So yet we've been hypersexualized, yet at the same time, our lack of sexuality is off as well because we're following someone else, absolutely. Greece and Rome, absolutely. Absolutely, not just men, gay men, absolutely. I wholeheartedly agree, Haiti Blue. And not only that, see, everything I'm looking at now as far as femininity is concerned, I'm trying to break down and also look at some of these stereotypes that we've been given as women, falsified itself as femininity, when all it really is this foreign sexuality. You know what I'm saying? Where, you know, you're gyrating and all this kind of stuff, simulating sex, and you're only attracting, I'm talking to women now, sorry, only attracting men who have that on their minds only. That's what they see at first. But see, we used to know that, though. You know, those were things that we were taught, you know, by other older women, you know, when they would tell you, you don't ride a horse when you get the cow and you can get the milk for free, all that kind of stuff, you know, those types of sayings, which also had some materialism attached to it, but I'm just using that as an example, okay, of some of the things that we were told, you know, where we didn't just freely give ourselves to men in this quote-unquote sexual revolutionary style that we're doing it in now, where women are going around having wants and sex with various men, you know, even though they're using a condom, but they're going around, I mean, acting like men. I mean, this is the characteristic of men, is to be weak when it comes to, you know, controlling their lust. I mean, this is their characteristic. It's been socialized in us, and, you know, they make men feel like they have no control over their sex organ, that they can't hold it back if a woman bear clothes or do whatever, you know, they say is whatever stimulates the man. And so here in the society, we have women now who have been socialized to literally think and to get around in a male-dominated society, basically. You know, even though we think we don't, but we do. You know, so here we are, women. Now we got our have sex with anyone free card. We could just, and get mad when, you know, somebody say, well, you know, sex for women is, you know, basically not that animalistic. I mean, it's more ritualistic and, which should be for both of them, actually. But I'm talking about women right now. Because of us being receivers, okay, is that we're receiving energy, okay? Now, how you want that energy to come to you is how you put your energy out. And if you putting out sexual energy, guess what? That's all your ass going to get back. That's what I'm saying. And that's why I'm addressing this issue of femininity. You see what I'm saying? Because I think that we've been duped and fooled as to what true femininity is. Now, they have all types of definitions for femininity that are in the Webster's Dictionary. And if you like, I could go to the dictionary and read one thing. I mean, it ain't a long one because I got this little Franklin Dictionary here, which doesn't take up a lot of, don't give you a whole lot of words in the definition. So we're going to just look up, what did I say? We're going to look up feminine. Feminine. Is that what I said? Feminine? Feminine. Let's see what feminine means. I mean, I'm just a little curious. I'd like to see what they say. It says of the female sex, characteristic of or appropriate or peculiar to women, of, relating to, or constituting the gender that includes most words or grammatical forms referring Right, so basically, it says that to be feminine in this particular context, in this dictionary, is simply to be of the female sex. Well, I wholeheartedly disagree with that. Because femininity is a quality. It is not just a characteristic. That's what I'd like to say. It isn't. So, you know, when we look at what makes a woman feminine, is it her clothes? Is it her makeup? Her hairstyle? How pretty she is? How well built she is? You know, we like to say she's built. She's, you know, she's banging. She's this or whatever, that. Or her uterus. What is it that makes a woman feminine? What if a woman found out that she couldn't have children? Would she be less feminine? Remember I said that femininity is not a characteristic, but a quality, okay? You have to have a quality of femininity. It's a quality, you know what I'm saying? Hey, you know what? I'm going to look up quality because I like to go to the dictionary. Everybody who listens to my shows know that. Because they basically coming off the top of my head on this show right now. So, peculiar and essential character, nature, degree of excellence, high social status, a distinguishing attitude. And I would go so far as to say it's number four, a distinguishing attitude. That is the definition of quality. So, to be feminine is a quality, not a characteristic, because every woman is not feminine. Let me say that again. Every woman is not feminine. And just so I can make it perfectly clear to each and every one of you who's listening, those characteristics that I described to you earlier in the show when I was talking about what the research stated about the attractive, what aroused men more, and I described to you characteristics like childlike smooth skin, big eyes, small noses and chins, as well as long eyelashes or high-pitched voices as being a feminine quality or a feminine characteristic. You know, as hard as my voice is, I know damn well I probably wouldn't arouse any of these men who find that kind of quality something that arouses them. I wouldn't fit that, and I know many, many, many women who would not fit that, okay? So are they less feminine because they don't have childlike smooth skin, big eyes, small noses and chins, long eyelashes and high-pitched voices? Now, I'm gonna just say this because I remember this. I remember television back in the day when it was just black and white, and I remember that the women had high-pitched voices. They made their eyes really big. They made their lashes really long. And guess what? They're doing it today. To say that's why they make us have and buy all that black stuff to put under your eyes and over your eyes to make them appear to be larger than they are. False eyelashes. Some of y'all even get them to your eyelids. You know what I'm saying? It's unbelievable. I know some that got tattoo mascara across their eyelid. Can you imagine somebody putting a needle with ink around your eyeball simply because you want to have a permanent eyeliner because your ass is too lazy to get up and put it on and wash it off if you want to look like that? I mean, it's unbelievable. But these are the things that many of us as women do so that we can appear to be feminine and sexy to our men. Unbelievable. So we ask the question, I know I do, what femininity is. You know, what it is, and according to the Queen, I don't see it a lot, okay? Because women have been socialized now to think like men. And when you think as a man thinketh, so is he. Okay? Yeah, and shave off the eyebrows. Look, my sister just said, She be looking like a clown or something with them drawn on eyebrows. Shave off their eyebrows. Shave them off. When you could just, you know, get them, I call it manicured. You can get them manicured and then just fill in. You know, ain't nothing wrong with enhancing what you already got. I'm not saying take it off and put something else on there. That's what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying? So we as women have been conditioned to go through all of these extremes to recreate ourselves to look like some images that were really created by men. Well, men have said, this is what I like. So they got us walking around in 7-inch stilettos, feet hurting like hell. You know what I'm saying? Putting all kind of chemicals and dye in our hair and, I mean, just doing all kind of stuff just so we could be attracted to men. I'm telling you, that don't work. It don't work. Now, I'm going to say that a man does like a nice, neat woman. He likes a woman that takes care of herself. He likes a woman that cares about how she dresses and how she looks. Not a woman who comes outside of the house. I mean, most men, real men, in my opinion, with her hair all over her head like she doesn't really care about herself. Because, I mean, how could someone care about you if you don't care about yourself? But see, this is what this society is cultivating. It's cultivating either excessive doting on oneself or just roll out the bed, take a shower, don't care how I look, you know, go on out there into the world and dare anybody to say anything still. That's what we digress to. Because as bad as it was, because, you know, back then we were plumb ignorant, and I don't have all the information that we have today. But at least there was some kind of I hate to use the word decent. You know what I'm saying? I hate to use the word because then I got to think of a definition to give you for how I mean it. Because I don't mean it decent like, okay, I'm going to say this. I don't think that we should be almost naked walking in the street. I don't think that. Now, and I think because, for the simple fact, that it's distracting, because it's not the norm of the culture. It's not the norm of our culture as African people to do that. You know what I mean? So it's not that we have to wrap ourselves up like a bandage. I'm saying as women, we have responsibilities as to how we arouse our men. How we arouse our men. Because it's my belief and understanding that, you know, arousing a man, I mean, if you're a woman, it doesn't take to get damn near naked to do it. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't take all that. So what we've been driven to is these excesses that literally have turned us into almost animals. Where we just acting on pure instinct. Ooh, I see you. I get aroused. Let's go to bed. I mean, just like that. You know, one night stands. I mean, sometimes I just can't. I can't believe how casual people, you know, do it these days. I mean, married people. This is just like, you know, everybody's having an affair. I just can't understand it. So to me, I think as women, we got to put the reins back in. I mean, we cannot keep allowing this to unfold in our society and we be a part of it when we are, so they say, and this is what they say, that we are the hand that rocks the cradle. You know what I'm saying? We are the hand that rocks the cradle. That's what they said. The hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. I believe that. What I don't believe is the woman being the first nurturer. I don't believe that. I mean, the first teacher. I don't believe that. But I do believe that she is the first nurturer and that she rules the world because she rocks the cradle first, which in my opinion, is where we as women have kind of like stepped off the plate, had to man up, you know, because of course men were, and they still do, walk away from their responsibilities. And they do it for various reasons. I'm not saying that in some instances some of them ain't right for the abuse that they have received at the hands of that woman simply because he would not do something that she wanted him to do, or that he was not going to allow her to just wantonly do some of the things that was detrimental to the relationship and the family simply because she wanted to. And that, yeah, so anyway. So here we are today, not as in the true feminine form that I think we were divinely created in. And, you know, and when I look at femininity, I do realize that, you know, as women are the weaker physically between men and women, I would say that it's physically true that women are weaker. There ain't no doubt about it. But to compensate for that physical weakness, we have to seek to overcome obstacles in this world, not by bodily strength, but by other means, namely using our quality of femininity, which entails a beauty, and I'm not talking about the beauty that we've been told is beautiful. You know, the peroxide blonde, that's about biggest of big pen, you know, that's not beauty. You know, that's not the beauty I'm talking about, or some kind of physical features that, you know, have been given to us as being beautiful. That's not beautiful. Or, you know, it's based on our goodness and, you know, just our nurturing spirit as women, as the keepers of peace. You know what I'm saying? Those are, to me, the qualities of femininity. The ability to soothe the quote-unquote savage beast, okay? To bring peace and harmony to the family. You know, and I think that it's not going to be incumbent upon one woman. It has to be something that's incorporated in our culture, in our society. You know what I'm saying? It has to be part of our society. So for me, you know, true femininity is more than being able to bear children. As I said before, it's more than beauty or any of those aesthetic or outer things. But it combines the gentleness of women's nurture with the strength of our determination. Because we are so much stronger than men when it comes from an emotional standpoint, even though we're physically weaker. So that's where the balance is that emotionally, I think we are stronger than men emotionally. Even though we cry, well, we cry because that's a good outlet for, you know, certain feelings and energy. So that's why we are more prone to cry. Not only that, we've been conditioned to be the ones that cry all the time. You know, men have been told they can't cry. But given opportunity, they cry more and more. They cry more and more now as we have the more effeminate male, you know, coming on the scene. So, you know, they're getting into their feminine side straight up. So they're kind of booking that men don't cry shit. Men is boo-hooing like you wouldn't believe, which is good. They need to let that pain or whatever they got out and cry and not go beat somebody about it. If more men was crying around here, we probably have less war. If men would just go have a good cry about it. A good cry about it. Shit. It'd probably all be good. But anyway, I just want to say for the record that to be feminine to me, and see, I know it's hard to explain what being feminine is because they got a website where you can go learn the art of being feminine. They got all these manipulative things I guess you're supposed to do, you know.